Okay, good morning to all the students. This was one of the questions which I received last time from Pawan Karnam. Okay, he asked me, sir, I understood this graph with regards to the audiogram. What does it mean when we say unmasked or masked? What is the difference between air conditioned unmasked and air conditioned masked? And similarly, bone conduction unmasked and masked. When do we diagnose this based on audiogram, and how does it make a difference if it's masked or unmasked when plotting the audiogram? What are the indications? What are the use of these symbols? Okay, so he has sent me this picture of Dhingra. So here, let me tell you, what's your name, boss? Pawan. Okay, Pawan. Pawan, the purpose of doing a masking, suppose you are wearing a earphone right now to listen to my class. Suppose one end of your earphone is kind of not working and the other ear end of the earphone is probably working well. What happens is sometimes there's a cross routing of this sound. If you have kept your earphones in the audio setting as high, sometime if you're having a problem in the right ear, in your right earphone, and you're unable to hear through it because probably it was damaged to some reason, and you're able to hear only from the left side, sometimes what happens is because of the vibrations, that is the air conduction transmission, that sound which is heard in your left ear, you hear it in your right ear. So what you have to do is, if you want to particularly test your right ear and avoid the same sound being transmitted to the left ear, you can mask it. Masking is nothing but you know, like just that giving just an FM sound where you hear that something like that. Okay, it is like you will be getting one ear, it's completely masked by a sound. It can be a pure tone sound or it can be a white noise, whatever it is, it will be masking that ear so that the person will not be able to hear anything from the left ear, and all the stimulus can be given to the right ear and you can test it accordingly. This is done in cases where a patient is not giving an appropriate response, or if the patient is giving unilateral hearing loss, or if the patient is malingering. Say, for example, a patient or someone, a convict, is in the jail and the police have beaten him up left and right, and because of that head injury, whatever he has sustained, he starts complaining of deafness. The police people take him to the nearest government hospital to find out whether he is really deaf or he is malingering. So they do this masking for patients who are not giving a proper response, or patients who have certain amount of hearing loss, which can be conductive pattern or it can be sensory neural pattern or mixed pattern. There are people who sometimes fake these kind of disabilities to get outcomes like monetary benefits and all those things. So masking is something which will help. So suppose if a patient says, I have completely left-sided hearing loss and right I'm able to hear, you will mask the right ear and you will give a 90 decibel sound in the left ear. If the patient is able to hear well, he will jump out. So that stapedial reflex will be triggered, and because of this you can test air conduction separately and bone conduction separately. Bone conduction is a separate gadget which is worn on the head, and that will also send a similar vibratory kind of a response. So this is the main purpose, and this symbols are already designated symbols which have to be followed. Okay, so this is something, if you're doing unmasked, it will be like this symbol, that is red and circle, and it is for the right ear. Remember, right is red and the opposite is blue, so you can just remember one opposite side, that can go ahead. And unmasked, the symbol changes to this. Unmasked is this, and the masked symbol is this. And bone conduction, masked, unmasked symbol is this, what you can see on the screen. And bone conduction, masked symbol is this. And if there is a no response, you'll have to make a symbol in your audiogram in that similar fashion. So I hope this answers your question. And with that, I would just go to my presentation. I believe some part of chronic otitis media was not covered. So just to run through that, and then I will be taking facial nerve and its disorders. So I will start this presentation, chronic otitis media. So what is chronic otitis media? What are the types of chronic otitis media? and etiology, pathology, the features, investigation and treatment. Remember, in your books it's mentioned as chronic separative otitis media. This terminology has been changed now. It has been mentioned as chronic otitis media. So it's a long-standing infection of a part or whole of the middle ear cleft, that is chronic otitis media, which is characterized by ear discharge and a permanent perforation. So this is a normal tympanic membrane A in this picture, and this is a picture which is having features of chronic otitis media, which shows a permanent rim of perforation. What do you mean by permanent central perforation is there will be a wide rim of perforation which will fail to close. Sometimes there is a small perforation, it will close. But if it is a patient who has chronic inflammation of the middle ear cleft, they will have a permanent perforation where the outer epithelial layer and the inner mucosal layer will merge, and the middle fibrous layer will be absent in the site of perforation. So because of this, what happens? Because of ingrown epithelialization with the outside end mucosalization, the middle fibrous layer will not grow in this area. So because of that, they will have this problem. Just give me a minute.
Hello, sir. Naniga class tagonta idini sir, undergraduate. I'll try to be finish it up quickly. Okay? Yeah. Now 9:30 is going on. I'll finish this class and then come. Okay? Yeah. Right. Thank you. Mali. No problem, sir. We'll do it. Okay. Sorry for the delay. Fine. What are the types of chronic otitis media? There are two types. It is tuvotympanic and aticoantral. Tuvotympanic is something which is called as safe or benign type. It involves in the anterior inferior part of the middle ear cleft, that is the eustachian tube and the mesotympanum. It is associated with the central perforation, and the risk of complications is minimal with this. Aticoantral is an unsafe or a dangerous type. It involves there is a posterior superior part of the cleft is involved, that is the attic, antrum and mastoid, and it is associated with the attic or a marginal perforation. The disease is also associated with bone eroding properties, as in cholesteatoma, which I covered in the previous class, and granulation or osteitis. The risk of complication in aticoantral type is high. So if this is the part of the nose, the maxillary sinus, nasal cavity, this is the eustachian tube, this is the tympanum, that is the middle ear cleft, and this is the attic, adytus and antrum, this is the mastoid air cells. So this part is the skull base, the attic part which is in the roof, and this part is the middle ear cleft. So what exactly happens if you have a perforation somewhere in the center of the tympanic membrane and in occupying the mesotympanum and the hypotympanum, then it's a kind of a safe type of perforation. If it is involving somewhere in the roof, pars flaccida and attic, there is a risk of this infection spreading to the skull, facial nerve and labyrinth, and in one causing mastoid infection. So this is something which is dangerous, which requires urgent attention. So if this image is understood proper, what are the factors which will cause chronic middle ear infection or inflammation of the middle ear cleft? It involves starting from the nose. It can be a simple cold, sinusitis. Even this adenoids can be blocking and causing negative pressure in the eustachian tube. Because of this, there can be a kind of effusion in the middle ear cleft. And because of this, there can be features of acute otitis media which can suppurate, and then this acute suppurative otitis media can become a chronic infection if left untreated. So if this infection, if there is involvement of the eustachian tube, chronic negative middle ear pressure, sometimes this will lead to retraction pockets. So because of this retraction pockets, there can be chronic inflammation, and because of that, it will lead to formation of cholesteatoma, which has bone eroding properties, osteitis and granulation. Because of this, this will lead to its complication. So difference between the tubotympanic and the aticoantral, you should know clinically how it looks like. Tubotympanic or the CF type, they will usually present with profuse or mucoid discharge. Aticoantral is usually scanty and purulent and foul smelling discharge. The perforation in a tubotympanic is usually central. In aticoantral, it is usually in the attic or the marginal. Remember, marginal is also unsafe, though it can be in the
pars tensa, but it's also involving the annulus and the tympanic membrane. Okay, so that can also lead to invagination of the squamous epithelium. So granulation is uncommon and it's common feature in adipocondral disease. Ear polyp can also be present in chronic inflammation, and it will be pale in appearance in tuber tympanic, and in adipocondral it can be red and fleshy appearance. Cholesteatoma, it is absent, but I would disagree with this point which is given in Dhingra. Sometime it can also be present here, but it's very rare. But few cases, yes, it can be present. Adipocondral or unsafe type, it is usually cholesteatoma is present. Complications are minimal, I would not say rare, in tuber tympanic, and in adipocondral it is very common. So the audiogram basis, it can be mild moderate conductive hearing loss in tuber tympanic. But in adipocondral, because of involvement of the surrounding labyrinth middle ear, there can be conductive or mixed kind of roughness. This is a picture of a tuber tympanic. So you say, how do you describe this kind of a perforation? So if we have to divide this entire, So if we have to divide this entire thing, so this is the umbo here. So normally we'll have to take a horizontal line here, okay, and another vertical line here, okay. So just avoid this, just forget about this. So this divide, this is divided into four quadrant, one, two, and three, and four. So these four quadrants will determine which, what is the location of the perforation. If it is a eustachian tube related perforation, chronic inflammation, so you'll have anterior superior kind of perforation, okay. So and anterior, this is like an anterior superior and inferior perforation. This is a posterior superior, posterior inferior perforation. Usually anterior superior, and if you compare it to posterior inferior, here you will find that the ossicles will be there. So if you have a patient who's having anterior superior perforation and posterior superior perforation, which patient will have higher hearing loss? It will be the patient with posterior superior. Why? Because there will be involvement of the ossicles and damage to the ossicles, so they will be having some higher amount of hearing loss. So remember this. So if you have a perforation which is central in the pars tensa with the surrounding rim of the normal anatomical remnants of the tympanic membrane, it is called a tuber tympanic disease. Okay, so if it is a small perforation or a pinpoint perforation, it will be involving one small quadrant, okay, less than 4 millimeters. If it is involving both quadrants, say one, this 2 and 4, it is a moderate kind of perforation. And if it is involving 2, 3, and 4, it is a large central perforation. And here, if it is involving the entire quadrant with the presence of the annulus, this is that bony tympanic annulus. If that is not involved, it is called a subtotal perforation. So suppose if you have any perforation here, which is involving the margins and the annulus, it is called a marginal perforation, which makes it a unsafe or an adipocondral type of disease. Okay, so this disease is usually, it starts in the childhood. It is a sequelae of an acute otitis. It infection, as I mentioned, the pathophysiology in the previous diagram itself, infection can be an ascending type of infection. Infection from the tonsils, adenoids, or sinuses are persistent, can lead to persistent infection and recurrent otorrhea. This can lead to patient presenting with chronic episodes of upper respiratory infection, which will predispose to ear discharge. So sometimes other factors like allergies can also result to a certain extent features of acute otitis leading to chronic otitis. So the pathology usually starts as a perforation and frequent inflammation of the middle ear mucosa, which later on may become polypoidal, and granulation may form if it is an adipocondral, and ossicular chain if involved can lead to some amount of hearing loss, and frequent inflammation. Following that, if there is a healing, it will become a tympanosclerosis, which is a white chalky deposit. If it is involving ossicles, that will also contribute to some amount of hearing loss, and it will also lead to fibrosis and retractions and adhesions. Okay, so all those things are a part of the pathology. Bacteriology, the pus you have to take the culture of these samples. How will you take a pus culture from a chronic ear? First, if at all the patient has tuber tympanic disease, the discharge will be coming out to the expiratory canal. So you will have contamination of the ear canal skin flora also. So first you have to do a proper oral toilet. Then you will take a small culture swab, or this the same swab which we use for testing corona. I think that fine small swabs. So we will have to take the swabs directly from the middle ear cleft or through the perforation, not from the ear canal. That will add to unnecessary contamination. And immediately the sample should be labeled and sent within 2 hours for adequate reports. Most commonly, what are the organisms grown? Pseudomonas, aeruginosa, proteus, E. coli, and staph aureus. Anaerobic bacteroids, fragilis, and anaerobic streptococci are also seen. Even proteus, klebsiella, and other organisms are also most common. So chronic otitis media, you should know this classification. It can be mucosal disease or squamous cell disease. It can be active or inactive, or it can be a healed perforation. So squamous cell disease, it can also be inactive, or it can lead to retraction pocket. You can't say it is inactive here, okay? So remember this definition. What do you mean by it is active? It is active, chronic otitis media, active. You say it is active when the patient is having active discharge at the time of examination. Patient comes to the OPD, say, I'm having ear discharge. You examine the ear. Ear canal is inflamed and there's pus and also a perforation which is permanent type, and pus is also coming out through the perforation. What do you mean by quiescent stage? In the recent past, the discharge was present, but at present, there is no discharge. Okay. So recently, sir, I had ear discharge, but after taking necessary treatment, the discharge stopped. So this is how some patients will present. What do you mean by inactive stage? Patient will have a remnant perforation which is permanent, but at the time of examination, there will not be any discharge. Usually the discharge will be absent for 3 to 6 months time. These are the patients whom we would preferably take up for surgery. Healed stage is when, suppose the epithelium and the inner mucosal layer are healing in a synchrony such that they don't enter the middle ear. So the tympanic membrane can be healed in that regards, especially when it's a small perforation or a traumatic perforation. So they will lead to a dimeric membrane. So they will have different classical appearance of the tympanic membrane in that stage. Clinical features, it includes ear discharge. It can be non-offensive, mucoid or mucoperlent. It can be constant or intermittent. And it is also associated with the hearing loss, which can be conductive, and it rarely exceeds 50 decibel. Okay. And perforation is always central, and middle ear mucosa can be also seen, which can also appear inflamed in this condition. What do you mean by round window shielding effect? If you have seen a term there, usually what happens, we have the malleus, incus, and stapes, and then is the oval window. And then so what happens is the disease in the middle ear cleft will try to sustain and try to protect so that there will not be damage. But when there is a release of osteitis, granulation, and the cholesteatoma, this membranes can be damaged. So this will result in mixed pattern of hearing loss. So because of the shielding effect of the round window, the hearing will be to some extent preserved. That is called round window shielding effect. Okay. So if you have a patient coming over after taking an appropriate history, usually a patient will come with history of ear discharge, reduced hearing. Sometimes they'll be having associated complications like facial nerve palsy or ringing sensation in the ear, tinnitus, or sometimes ear pain and fever. So these are all complications. So if a patient comes with ear discharge without any associated symptoms, we normally say it is safe after examining the tympanic membrane. If the patient has pain or any associated symptoms like fever, giddiness, ringing sensation, headache, and all these symptoms, you will have to evaluate him and you will have to take necessary, do necessary investigations. So first you will examine the ear under microscope, do an oral toilet, take a culture swab, and then you will also request the patient to get an audiogram baseline hearing assessment done. And then you will also get an X-ray mastery bilateral. and to see what is the purpose of getting the X-ray mastoid is to find out the pneumatization of the mastoid air cells, and if there is any associated complications for which you may need to go for higher investigations like HRCT temporal bone. Oral toilet, as I mentioned, is very important. And eardrops, antibiotic eardrops containing neomycin, polymyxin, chloromycetin, and gentamicin are used, and it can be combined with steroids, which have local anti-inflammatory effect. Normally, the effect of the local medicines are much better than taking oral antibiotics, because higher concentration of these local medicines will try to heal the middle ear cleft. But at the same time, we should remember that chronic use of these eardrops will lead to fungal infection, risk of sensory neural hearing loss. So it is not that we should tell our patient to constantly use eardrops if at all they are having ear discharge. It has to be judiciously used and observed. And systemic antibiotics can be given, and precautionary measures. You should tell the patient that he has a perforation in the ear. He can't indulge in activities like swimming or scuba diving, which or any water contact sports. Okay, so these are certain things which will probably worsen the condition. So ear discharge patient will worsen if at all there is water entry to the affected ear. So you should also treat the contributory causes. For example, if any adenoids are present or if it's a deviated nasal septum is present, you will have to do the necessary medical management or surgical necessary management for the same. If there's any allergic factors as a contributory cause, you will have to treat allergy also. Surgical treatment is usually the gold standard. You will have to treat most of the patients by surgery. And as if you have gone through my previous lectures, there are certain prerequisites where you can give medical management for patients, one, who are refusing the surgery because they don't want to undergo, or if they are having other concurrent infections or comorbidities or higher age. So these kind of patients you usually manage by medical management. Usually surgery is the treatment of choice. If you have any patient with chronic otitis media, you will give medical treatment to render the ear dry and reduce the infection and the bacterial load. But you will also counsel the patient that he may need to undergo surgery. And reconstructive surgery in terms of ocelloplasty and tympanoplasty needs to be done. So this is a case of atrochoanteral disease. So if you look here you will find that there is a retraction pocket and an atric kind of a defect. Okay, this though it also has a central perforation here. So it's a combined kind of a issue. So it usually involves the posterior superior part of the middle ear cleft. It can be associated with cholesteatoma, and it is also termed as unsafe or dangerous type. So cholesteatoma can be because of several theories, because of invagination theory, metaplasia theory, or some squamous cell press in the ear. Because of this, they will tend to develop chronic retractions, and because of frequent middle ear inflammation, there will also be a risk of retraction pockets which will develop. Okay, because of this, it will lead to sclerosis of the mastoid air cells. The pathology will be because of cholesteatoma, osteitis and granulation, ossicular necrosis, and cholesterol granuloma. So here you can see that there is attic cholesteatoma. What exactly happens is usually there is a retraction pocket. Say you have a cold and you have a badly deviated nose. Because of that, you are not able to breathe properly. So your particular ear, say your nose is deviated, your nasal septum is deviated to the right side, and you have this discomfort or block sensation in the right ear. You try to blow your nose, still you're not able to pop the ear. So what exactly happens? Over the period of time, you will develop a retraction in the tympanic membrane, and this retraction in some time give way and tear. It may become a traumatic tympanic membrane or a retraction. And sometimes the skin will grow inwards into these areas, and it will get probably traumatized or infected. Traumatized probably by using earbuds, or infected secondarily to the infections because of chronic upper respiratory infection or acute otitis media or acute suppurative otitis media. What exactly happens? This retraction pockets goes on eroding the deeper structures because the skin is growing inwards. So the skin has this proper activities of keratolytic activities and osteotic activities. It will start invading deeper. So that is what will cause an issue. Okay. So the bacteriology is the same as the tubular tympanic type, and symptoms. I would request all students to mute their audio, please. Thank you. Symptoms will be usually a scanty discharge followed by a foul smelling discharge because of osteitis and bone destruction. So cholesteatoma here, what exactly you mean by this? Normally we have a intact tympanic membrane. Just a minute. I think my voice is echoing. Kindly mute yourself for audio, all the students. Thank you. Hearing is usually normal when the ossicular chain is intact. So normally when we have a hearing, normal patient with a normal tympanic membrane, malleus, and tapes, it's usually fine. But what happens here, sometimes because of this chronic ear discharge cholesteatoma, the bone would have usually been destroyed because of the cholesteatoma, because it has bone eroding properties. And because of this, what happens? Chronic granulation tissues will bridge the gap between this destroyed ossicles. So it will fake or mimic our brain telling that everything is normal, the hearing is normal. But when we go and operate this patient, we'll find that there's a gap between the ossicles, and usually a granulation tissue or cholesteatoma is usually bridging the gap between these ossicles. That's why the sound is getting transmitted. So these patients are known as cholesteatoma hearers. If you are trying to address these patients by oral toilet or examination under microscope, when you try to clean the ear discharge and the ear canal, and you also see there is some kind of a granulation, and sometimes even a polyp will also be present. It will bleed on touch. Okay. Signs, there can be perforation, it can be attic or posterior superior, and because of that, frequent inflammation, retraction pockets can also be present. And there are four stages of the tympanic membrane retractions. I will discuss that. And cholesteatoma, the skin getting invaginated, can also be a problem. So the stages can be stage one. So four stages are here. Stage one, tympanic membrane is retracted, but it does not come in contact with the incus. So stage two is the tympanic membrane is retracted deep and it's in contact with the incus. The middle ear mucosa is not infected. Stage three is also when you call it as the atelectasis. What happens is the tympanic membrane goes and gets adherent to the promontory. On Valsalva or sigillization, on increasing the pressure, it will come out. So this is usually noted in stage three. Stage four is when it's completely adhesive. Even if you do a Valsalva maneuver, the tympanic membrane is literally adherent. There is no space in the middle ear. These are the patients who will have higher amount of hearing loss. So examination involves same examination in the microscope, tuning fork test, and audiogram, X-ray, mastoid, CT, and culture sensitivity of the ear discharge. So this audiogram, you have to notice, this is a sensorineural kind of pattern. You understood my previous question, the question which was asked by one of the students. Here, remember this audiogram, right? Red color is right, okay? Blue color is left. So you understood this concept? If you are testing for the hearing, you will start with air conduction. Normally, air conduction is better than bone conduction sounds. So air conduction is denoted by this symbol as the circle. Bone conduction is denoted by this symbol as it is to the right side, so it is facing to the right side. Okay, so that's how you can remember. And if you find normally this is the bone conduction sound, so air conduction and bone conduction will be present accordingly and mapped according to the frequencies 250, 500, 1000, 2000, 4000, and 8000 hertz. So here you will find that this bone conduction is slightly higher, okay, and air conduction is lower. Okay, and this airborne gap is there. So see, here it is 5 decibel, here it is 50 decibel, almost 45 decibel average, and here it is becoming 30 30 30. So almost this patient has 35 to 40 decibel hearing loss conductive pattern. So the airborne gap is more here, here the airborne gap is less. So this accounts to sensory neural loss. So HRCT of the temporal bone is very important. See, this is a normal, forget about this text here. I want you to focus on this CT scan. This is a normal right-sided temporal bone. Here you can see the mastoid. And here you can see this is the part of the middle ear labyrinth. Okay, cochlea. No, this is not the labyrinth, this is the cochlea. This is the part of the external trichina. This is some part of the remnant tympanic membrane in this picture. Here, because of chronic inflammation, the air cells have become sclerosed. Okay, so this is all those things you need to know. Here you can see in the sagittal section, this is the same thing. In the sagittal section, you can see the malleus and incus. Okay, so here on the left side, a 14-year-old boy, eardrum is thickened, and the small arrow which is visible between the scutum and the auscular chain, but no adhesion is present. So this favors diagnosis of chronic otitis media. Just forget about these points here, but I want you to remember something. If it is a cholesteatoma, this particular area, my pointer, wherever it's pointed right now, this is called the Prusak space. That will be a site of weak link and where cholesteatoma can get ingrown, and then there will be issues of chronic ear. Tympanosclerosis is when there is a patchy particular area of hyalinization calcific deposition, okay, over the tympanic membrane. Sometimes it can be involving the ossicles, and it may also involve the round windows, so it may lead to some amount of hearing loss. This is the jugular bulb. This is the carotid artery, okay, so this is just for information. This is the cochlea, cut sections of the cochlea. Coming to the it is an infection secondary to the pulmonary tuberculosis. Infection can reach through eustachian tube or blood-borne infection. It is usually seen in patients who are active cases or in young children or adults. It is slow and insidious process. So what is the characteristic features of tubercular otitis media? I'll tell you. Usually patients will have multiple perforation. They'll be having painless ear discharge. Sometimes these perforation can become all coalesced and become a large perforation. So usually these are the patients who will be having a large perforation and pale granulations, and there will be some amount of caries and ossicles can also be inflamed, leading to complication. Similar complications of all CSOM with cholesteatoma is present. Kindly mute your audio, please. I can hear your voice. Audio, please. Everyone, just mute it. Yes, sir. Okay. I have just another couple of slides, another five slides. Just a minute. Okay. Urvashi, can you tell your friends to mute their audio, please? Yeah, tell your friends to mute their audio. I'll just finish this up. Okay, the clinical features, usually they present with the painless ear discharge, and they cannot present with multiple perforation, and hearing loss will be present in these patients. Sometimes there can be conductive or sensory ear, and facial palsy is also common in these kind of patients. Usually you'll have to take a swab from the ear culture and send it for acid fast bacillar testing, and you can also remove the granulation and send it for histopathological examination. Chest X-ray and sputum analysis can also be useful. And presently, DNA probe and PCR testing is also useful, and it can give accurate results in 3 to 7 days. Treatment is starting anti-tubercular drugs, and local treatment in the form of oral toilet and mastoid surgery is indicated if there's any complication. Healing is usually delayed, and usually these kind of patients, they will classically present with chronic episodes of ear discharge despite undergoing a successful surgery. If you find a patient coming with episodes of 3 to 4 past histories of surgical intervention and still having ear discharge, you should suspect tubercular otitis media. Syphilitic otitis media is a rare condition similar to that of the pathological spread of tuberculosis. It is blood-borne or eustachian tube infection. What is the pathology here is the sensory end organs of the inner ear and the nerves are invaded by this treponema pallidum infection. This leads to sensory neural hearing loss, tinnitus, and vertigo. Because of the chronic inflammation, it leads to bone necrosis, and chronic osteomyelitic features will lead to sequestrum formation, which will lead to a foul smelling ear discharge. Secondary infection can also occur, which may mimic like a chronic otitis media. So unless you take sample for testing, and to get some blood investigations like VDRL, treponema pallidum, hemagglutination test, you will not be able to diagnose this condition. It will be usually missed. So VDRL, rapid reactive plasma reagent test are non-specific, but they are usually useful to monitor the disease process. So treatment involves antisyphilitic therapy, the benzathine penicillin, oral toilet, control of secondary infection, and the surgery to remove the sequestra. Okay, so that's with it. Actually, right now, what I will do, I will stop the class here. I have been called there's a meeting for COVID sample collection. Our hospital is trying to get an accreditation for NABL. Okay, so if possible, I will try to take another class today in the evening, if it's okay with your friends, and I will give the attendance along with that. We'll fix up a time, and Urvashi and Praveen Kannan will let me know what time is okay. Maybe in the evening also is fine. I will be ready for it. So we can have the facial nerve covered in that class. Okay, so I will finish both these topics today. I'm already ready. See, facial nerve is already, it's already, we have quite a lot of slides, and it's kind of very important and to know about this. So as of now, I'll just stop here. And see, attendance, I will give full attendance to everyone. I don't have any issues. But the thing is, one second. Okay. Fine. Attendance is not an issue. I will try to address it. So don't worry from my side. I think those who have not joined my class, no issues. I will have this recorded. You can watch it later. Evening, what time? Urvashi and Praveen Kannan, just tell me what time is okay and feasible, so that we can cover the facial nerve topic as well. And remember, these topics will not be included. I mean, the topic covered till 6th of this month will be included for your exams. The topic after 6th will not be added to your exams, which is as scheduled, okay? So don't get stressed and all those things. I know you guys will not get stressed, but one thing. Yes, Praveen, anything? Sir, one request. What is it? Just shoot. Okay, fine. I'll fix up a time and we'll get to it. Okay, so whatever it is, we'll stop this meeting now. Fine.